And here, a huge stone dot stage with religious protocols of them, the stadium seating, was specially built for President Bush visit. The Camp Venerative Bill one here tells tourists they have one of their place, and the village entrance road here, of course, pressing too hard, is marked with vested banners and fashion. Chinese ethnic peoples. Minority ethnic visual identity is a key component of Chinese regional identity in the northwest and southwest. In addition to the tourist villages, ethnic theme parks have been established in Kunming, providing a condensed version of Yunnan for the tourists, and in Shenzhen, near Hong Kong, where the four ethnic and folk theme parks provide entertainment and a totalizing view of Chinese national ethnicities. To a large extent, Kunming advertises itself as a measurement of the diverse populations of Yunnan. And I think here we go to the video. So I wanted to change. Do we have the video over there? The sound?
The video. Video is not good. The phone.
We have the sound. I can't hear it. Are you going to play it or not?
I'm not sure what's going to happen.
Okay. My picture is the beginning of the video. Shall I play the video or are you going to play? Thank you.
Next, please.
Thank you. 那就是通过认真的研究和考虑，通过比较大深入的大幅度的发挥，进而把教育的民族文化精神
Okay, Jerry, you're back. I hope you go to the class now. And there's nothing as much as China. In Japan, there's been very little recognition of ethnic diversity until the last few years. Cultural regionalism has played out in terms of famous things by which the media and tourists can appreciate iconic authority. But serious regional movements, such as Ryukyu or United States and self-government, are not tolerated. Since the Meiji Restoration of 1868, the emphasis has been on assimilation and Tanitsu-nihon, which means one ethnicity, one nation. Even though Japan signed the United Nations Declaration on Ethnic and Minority Rights in the 1980s, it refused to recognize the indigenous Ainu as a separate cultural group until 1995. Meanwhile, the Ainu have been trying to salvage their separate cultural identity and rights to land and property, and they have combined ethnic revivals with the economic aid of tourism. There are a few Ainu tourist villages in Hokkaido, where material culture is on display, and dancing, music, and secular rituals are performed. Some of these even act as nurseries for the revival of language and cultural learning by Ainu children. However, the vast majority of non-Japanese cultural attractions are recreations of famous foreign countries. These are carried out to such a remarkable degree of accuracy, often with imported work and materials, that they resemble almost the post-modernity or even the simulacra that Umberto Eco and Jean Baudrillard found in the western United States. This, for instance, is a street scene in Venice, which is actually part of Disney's Sea theme park in Tokyo. Though there is a long tradition of Japanese emulation of the cities, architecture, and gardens of other countries and distant places, and a fascination with the physical and cultural equipment of the Western world since the 19th century, the production of exact copies of foreign environments began in the 1970s. Perhaps the first was this government-sponsored national museum called Little World, Littoruado in Japanese, where they built a rural park near Nagoya. It was developed as part of the national government's policy of Kokusaika, or internationalization. Little World Park has enough space for each of the national pavilions to stand separately. Some of them are simply architectural exemplars imported as complete buildings, such as the Toba Batak Longhouse up here. Others are reproductions to be looked at, like the interior of this African house. But many of the larger compounds are interactive, with facilities for shopping, eating, drinking, dressing up in foreign national costumes, and of course buying souvenirs. And this is a Taiwanese headless compound. There's a lot of booths in here for eating and buying souvenirs. This South German Bavarian village inn, or Gasthaus, was one of the more recently built projects, providing opportunities for eating and drinking German style and buying German products. Some say the exact accuracy has given way to commercial expediency in the reproduction of this building, but I was unable to tell. This Italian restaurant from Apulia in southern Italy has a distinctive regional style. It was imported stone by stone and reconstructed by Italian workmen. It has an excellent restaurant and some shops. And in another part of it, one can listen to classical arias sung by opera singers from Italy. Next to eating and drinking and buying souvenirs, the most popular activity is dressing up and walking around the park in foreign national clothing. Often, foreign assistants brought in from foreign countries for a few months at a time to work in these pavilions help putting on the clothing. These experiences allow Japanese to meet foreigners and to try out foods and drinks and shopping and dressing up in an atmosphere of fun, using their own money and language. Please note on the poster here, which quite accidentally is imitated by a Japanese girl who walked in front of me while I was taking a photo of the poster, who is exactly dressed up as she's supposed to be This here says, see, eat, wear, and buy. These are those are the commands to the businesses. Very difficult, the whole thing part of seeing. Foreign villages or guy from the widow. Soon after the little world opened, other more commercial foreign living projects emerged. There are or were at least 20 of these guy from the widow, each representing stereotypes and positive aspects of the foreign country, with opportunities to eat, drink, buy, and play. Few of them were commercially successful, but some of the Japanese creators thought of them as much more than financial investments. They are ideological attempts at architectural, ecological, and social reform in Japan. Further amongst them is this place, Hustenbosch, a $3 billion reconstruction of the Dutch town in a desolate coastal area near Nagasaki. During the Japanese period of self-imposed preservation from 1641 to 1853, the Dutch were granted a complete monopoly over Japan's trade with the outside world through Dejima, a small artificial island in Nagasaki, which has retained a strong connection with the Dutch. Planned in the economically expansive 1980s, it has copied famous Dutch buildings such as the Dutch Royal Palace, called Kastenbosch, and the Dom Tour, the cathedral tower of Utrecht, in a planned town that includes both entertainment and residential areas. On the surface, it features Dutch attributes such as windmills and tulips, but it is actually a no-expense spare, advanced ecological project of recycled water, garbage, and sewage, and co-generated energy, all hidden and underlying the comfortable modern of living. The designers and the owners go even further, claiming that Hustenbosch is today what the early modern city of Edo, now called Tokyo, used to be, with its many canals, its sophisticated living, and its low-tech ecological footprint. Though Hustenbosch and other maker products in Japan have gone bankrupt, their backers take the long view, saying, quote, in 1,000 years, this will be looked upon as one of the marvels of 20th century Japan, unquote. What will we learn from this initial and only brief look at some of the characteristics of contemporary tourism in these two huge countries? One reason for considering them together is that comparisons include similarities as well as differences. And in some ways, China is catching up to what Japan has been practicing for some decades. This is a regional version of the what's globally has been called convergence theory. For instance, the relatively sudden granting of permission for Chinese to tour overseas in large groups to approved places starting in the 1990s resembles very much the first mass group tourists of the Japanese which were granted permission in the 1960s, with the notable exception that the Chinese take their children with them and the Japanese didn't. One can also note, through the choice of what to represent and portray these villages and parks, has varied from the most backward of domestic minorities for a while to the most sophisticated of European nations. But both of them are presented in what I call the folkloric regime. One which draws upon the somewhat idealized past, not of the troubled history of today's world with its anomalies and problems. For instance, nearly all the foreign assistants in the pavilions of Little World are traditionally dressed in traditional or peasant dress, and nearly all the clothes that the Japanese women choose to dress up in are traditional, much as the kimono is in today's Japan, rather than everyday wear. Similarly, the inhabitants of the Chinese ethnic villages and theme parks are supposed to wear their recognizable traditional clothing, which not only marks age and gender, as does contemporary Chinese and Western clothing, but also nationality. And the buildings show a similarly nostalgic and idealized style. This is most obvious in the Chinese villages, where traditional styles must be kept for presentation, whereas in many other rural minority villages, they are giving way to modern forms of construction and more general Chinese regional style. Naturally, it carefully selects buildings from all over Holland, focusing on those which are old and famous, and thus which have stood the test of time and are touristic. In the Chinese villages, it is overwhelmingly the young women who are presented and present themselves. Young women paradoxically represent tradition. They are seen as the keepers of the culture by being more homebound and less likely to be out competing with the modern urban world. And in their youth, they have not been corrupted and assimilated by the outside world. I have previously shown this also to be true in my study of Japanese hot spring resorts, and it also applies to the women who serve in the national pavilions of the world. Furthermore, the minorities themselves are gendered and sexualized as feminine, as Louisa Stein has shown. Though the marriageless and free-loving Mosul women, as you saw, are the extreme target of Chinese fascination and men's desires, nearly all minority women are under sexual pressure in these tourist encounters. This is not true of Kastenhof, where European civilization is emulated rather than penetrated, and is perhaps best symbolized by mature experts, either male or female. It should also be noted that the nature of the audiences, as well as the employers, has a lot to do with the roles chosen to be represented. For instance, the majority of Chinese tourists who go to the ethnic Southwest are young and middle-aged men. The majority of the tourists who dress up in the world are young women, with or without children, and they feel comfortable being dressed up by other young women, these foreigners who are there for a few months at a time. However, the majority of visitors and residents at Kastenhof may be older, more worldly wise, and interested in other tastes and appetites. Swedish anthropologist Appleman has shown, for instance, that many of them in their younger days were ardent fans of Disneyland and other Victorian theme parks, but now settled for something more sophisticated and more European. Both China and Japan are concerned with their national fabric within and with their relationships to the outside world as well. However, China, which calls itself Hongbo, the central kingdom, has in recent decades, as for much of its history, been more concerned with internal struggles and less with outer threats. Domestic tourism in China approaches the west and southwest provinces as places that are less securely part of their country as an integrated developed nation. In fact, there is a huge campaign now called Develop the West. At the same time, there are concerns that the people of the West, the minority groups, are less securely part of the modern nation than the majority of non-Chinese. This is especially true for Tibet and the Islamic regions of Xinjiang. The mass ethnic tourism is both to show the majority what and who their western flank consists of, and at the same time, overwhelming the minorities demographically and economically, and teaching by repetition that all minority peoples are together equally part of the great nation, and that they should cooperate as allies in the nation. There is a saying, only together can we build the mountain. Though the emphasis on maintaining national differences as they work together may appear to resemble that kind of organic solidarity between different peoples, we must remember the guiding principle that the former Commissioner for Nationalities of the USSR, the late Georgian Joseph Stalin, propounded, quotes, "Nationalism in form, but socialism in content. That is, the differences are superficial, and the guiding principle is mechanical solidarity." The reenactment of stereotyped traditional performances for tourist purposes is not only a lesson in reform in reinforcing minority equality, it is, as Oates has shown in his work on the Miao Guizhou, through these performances of tradition, tourism is supposed to bring or impose modernity on the hinterland of Dingzhu. It is by drawing attention to their traditions that they are shown what not to be, except, of course, when performing for paying outside tourists. In the Shen Zhen video excerpts, we learn of a new development in ethnic performance. that is, Chinese minorities playing the role of minority group performers in the rest of the world, usually the Han, who until recently were considered to be the most primitive of Chinese minorities, that are chosen allegedly because of their dark or black skin, play the Maori or the Africans in these performances. This superficially biological acting ability is also reflected in the choice of the safeguarding part of Mongolians to play North and South American Indians, which I didn't show. Apparently, someone has learned that American Indians, or indigenous peoples of North America, are Mongoloids, and they conflated that word with their own identity as Mongolians, and thought they were of the same blood, and therefore able to act them. But this new trend also reflects Chinese growing concern about how to know the outside world, that they are just beginning to be native tourists. Just as little world can help prepare Japanese for travels abroad, these performances put Chinese, potential Chinese tourists, a bit in the know about the makeup of the world outside of China. The Japanese has always had concerns about our minimum relationships to outside nations. Ever since Japan imported Chinese Buddhism, writing systems, architecture, city planning, and eating habits from China in the 5th to 7th centuries. This anxiety was again emphasized by Japan's submission to the demands and rules of the Western world in the 19th century. At a time when it had recently incorporated the Ainu of Hokkaido and the Ryukyu of Okinawa into the growing political body. Japan sought to suppress ethnic and regional diversity, especially through centrally controlled educational system. The differences which made up the whole have been expressed as the neighborhoods of the famous things that iconically mark a place's identity in the nation. These are often specific products which are exported from an area to the rest of Japan, or equally, specific events that contributed to the history of the Japanese nation. And these are reflected in the omiyage, the souvenirs that Japanese tourists take home for their friends and relatives. In both cases, we see the parts of the whole as being forms of organic solidarity. The emphasis in Japan is on history, whereas in China, much of it is about the future. In recent history, the Japanese have become major traders and travelers throughout the world, and their concern with acceptance and value measurements has been expressed in these policies of Saikan internationalization, and most recently in Hokkaido Saikan domestic internationalization, with an increasing proportion of foreign residents living in Japan. These Gaikokumura, foreign villages, offer foreign experiences for a population that, whether they travel or not, is concerned with understanding the outside world and the outsiders who increasingly inhabit their own country. Omoto Toyo Empaku, as Shakespeare said, the stage is a common metaphor with which to think about tourism. Dean McCampbell developed his concept of stage authenticity following the dramaturgical sociology of his mentor Irving Goffman. Little World and Gaikokumura are stages constructed by Japanese entrepreneurs that both exhibit an incredible mastery of foreign things by copying them or improving them, and allow the people to act out their fantasies of being foreign or acting correctly in foreign places. It is in the consideration of concepts of authenticity and replication that we are most challenged. Neither the Chinese entrepreneurs' assertion that authenticity is a base level that can be greatly improved upon in two further levels towards a fantastic stage performance, nor the Japanese admiration of exact replication coincide with common Western notions about creativity or intellectual and artistic integrity. Perhaps I may conclude by saying that the authenticity which the Chinese entrepreneurs improves upon is that of the minority Minzu cultural expressions. But these minority cultural expressions have no value at all to this entrepreneur except as sources of inspiration for creating, entertaining, and commercial performances. Whereas the European interests of reproducing self-exactly, on great value to them as something that they would like to build upon in their own country and eventually surpass. Thank you very much for your patience.